Teresa Mustard Seed Sewing. Thank you for joining me again on this episode of Truthful Tuesday. And today we're going to dive into part two of learning how to do homiletics. If you haven't already watched part one, I would encourage you to stop this video and go back to part one and watch it first. It's probable that the rest of this video won't make much sense to you if you haven't already watched part one. So I'll put a link to part one in the description box below. We'll do a quick review of the first three steps that we talked about last time, and then we'll go on for the final two steps. So the first three steps are your content listing, your subdivisions, and then your subject sentence. So the content listings are facts only, and you're going to have 10 to 20 content listings regardless of the length of the passage. It's kind of like you're taking notes over the passage. You're thinking about what's being said and jotting some thoughts down. Doesn't have to be complete sentences. You know, symbols are great, phrases, couple of words, whatever works for you to help you remember the facts that are happening in this passage. The second step are the divisions, and for any given passage that you're studying, you're going to have 2 to 4 divisions. And those will be summarized in grammatically correct sentences. Again, we're dealing with facts only. And as you're going back over your content listing, reviewing it, you're going to look for natural breaks or divisions in those content listings. And that'll be how you come up with your divisions. You write out your sentences that summarize the passage. You're shrinking the passage down a little bit more than you did in the content listing, and be sure to include the scripture address for that group of verses that you've made into a division. And the third step we talked about is the subject sentence. And for many people, this and the aim are the most challenging parts of doing homiletics. Still facts only, we're shrinking even more and summarizing the passage, again, in a grammatically correct sentence, but this time one sentence that is 10 words or less. And you want to try to word the sentence in such a way that it identifies the passage that you are learning about or teaching about. So those first three steps, they focus on the facts only. You want to get the information from the passage into your mind on a piece of paper. You're shrinking and condensing all of that information down into that one final subject sentence. So our last two steps are the aim and the application questions. And the aim is where you think about what am I learning from this passage, or what do I want my audience to learn? If you were teaching this particular passage, what do I want my audience to learn? What do I want them to take away? It could be what you've learned while you were studying the passage. And lots of times, any one passage could have many different aims. And I just want to take a second to say that homiletics in general, your homiletics is probably going to look really different from my homiletics, and my homiletics is going to look different from the next person's homiletics, and that is absolutely okay. There is no such thing as homiletics police, okay? We are all in different places in our walk with Christ, and the Holy Spirit is going to be working on each of us a little bit differently as we're going through a particular passage. And so if I have 10 content listings for this passage and somebody else has 15, that doesn't make one right and one wrong. It's just different. God created us different. He has an imagination and he is creative, and he didn't want us to sit in boredom looking at 100 million of the same people for however long we're here on this earth. So that would be true of divisions at all. Also, somebody for a passage might have 2 divisions. Somebody else might have 3, and somebody else might have 4, and that's okay. That is absolutely okay. But when we come down to the subject sentence, we're going to have one subject sentence, 10 words or less. Some people might have 8 words or 9 words. That's okay too. So, but when we come to our aim, we are looking for What is the primary truth that the author of the passage is trying to convey? What is he trying to communicate to the reader through this place in Scripture? This is going to be a main truth that is going to be true throughout the entire Bible. It's going to be doctrinally correct. You're not creating new theology here in your aim. It can be about God or it could be about man. And some people like to think about what do I want to cause my audience to learn? And some people like to think about that as they're preparing the aim. The aim is a sentence. It's doctrinally correct. It's theologically sound. And it's true of any place in Scripture that you would go to look at. And so for our passage here in John chapter 3, verses 1 through 21, I put a picture up there for you of my aim. And it struck me as I was going through the passage this time, not really paid much attention to the light and the darkness that was talked about. And so my aim, this is what I said, being born of the Spirit brings eternal life. Love of the darkness brings eternal damnation. Being born of the Spirit brings eternal life or eternal light. And love of the darkness brings eternal damnation. Now, is this true everywhere in the Bible? Is there any place in the Bible that I could go and read and learn that this principle is not true? I don't believe so. Okay, is this doctrinally sound? Is this theologically sound? If I went to my pastor or to the most godly, Bible knowledgeable person that I knew and told them this sentence, would they agree with me? Yes. This is true. This is right off the pages of Scripture. You nailed it on the head. So it's a question to ask yourself as you're preparing your aim. Is this biblically sound? And again, your aim may look totally different from mine, and that's okay because we're in different places in our walk with the Lord. Okay, then the final step is application questions. And this can be challenging, but in a good way, you know, because one of the main purposes of why we read Scripture, why we study it, is to learn about God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit, but also then to do something with what we're learning. It's great that we study the Bible and we learn all of these stories and we learn people's names and this happened when this happened and this person was the father of this person. There is nothing wrong. There's nothing inherently wrong with learning what is contained within the pages of Scripture. But then what do we do with all of that information? Just sit up here and collect brain space, collect brain dust, just sit there worthless? Or do we do something with it? Do we apply it to our lives? Do we apply it to our heart and in doing so become more Christ-like, less of me and more of him? So that's the purpose of the application questions, to get at our heart, to determine how does this apply to my life? What maybe I need to make some changes because of what I've learned in this passage. So the way to format your application questions is to remember that you have one application question for each division. So in this case, I had two divisions back in step two. So I'm going to have two application questions. You want to target your heart. And you, obviously, you're putting your sentences in the form of a question. Okay, so full disclosure up front here, I typically do more than one question for each division because I get to thinking and praying and things speak to me. So that's what you're going to see on the picture I'm going to put up here. Okay, so my first application question, or set of application questions, is, my first question was, am I experiencing new life in Christ? And that's a yes or no question, which that's okay, but it's not really getting at my heart. But you'll see as I go on with my other questions, okay, now she's getting down to the heart. She's making herself think about what's going on here. Am I experiencing new life in Christ? If not, why not? Why am I not experiencing new life in Christ? And who am I going to talk to about my eternal future this week? If I am not experiencing new life in Christ, there's a reason. You know, maybe someone who's watching this video isn't experiencing new life in Christ. What? Why? Why is that? What are you afraid of? Has no one explained the gospel to you? Have you had a bad experience in church? There could be lots of different reasons. So who are you going to talk to about experiencing new life in Christ? Who are you going to talk to this week? And I put that qualifier on there, a time frame. You know, otherwise it's just so easy to blow it off. And it's like, okay, I'll do that someday. Put your piece of paper, put your homiletics away, and the question's gone. What am I going to do this week about it? Am I experiencing new life in Christ? If I am, if so, have I grown complacent? And so what will I do today to rekindle my first love? I don't want to be complacent when it comes to my relationship with Jesus. I don't want to be complacent about sharing him with other people. I don't want to be complacent about my life of prayer. So again, I said, what will I do today to rekindle my first love? Again, I'm getting at my heart. Yes or no questions can be really helpful, but the main point of application questions is to get at your heart, to cause you to think, to drill down, to search, to go to the Lord in prayer and find out, why am I thinking this way? Why is this thinking process, why is this not lining up with Scripture? Okay, so then my second application question, and again, I did a set there as well. Bad teacher, I know. It's what works for me. Remember I told you back in the first, in part one, that, you know, I kind of tweaked this a little bit for myself. Well, this is an area where I did a little bit of tweaking. Those sets of questions help me to be able to go deeper. So the second one, which was for the second division, remember my first division covered verses 1 through 10, and my second division covered verses 11 through 21. Jesus explains how one can be born again and about life versus light versus darkness. So my application question for that division, does my life reflect the light? And if you noticed, I capitalized the word light because I meant, intended for that word to reflect, no pun intended, to reflect Jesus. Does my life reflect the light? Is that light dim or burning brightly? So yes or no question, does my life reflect the light? If it is, yes. Is it burning dimly or is it burning brightly? And another way to look at this particular division was, if I was on trial for loving Jesus, would there be enough evidence to convict me? Would I be found guilty of loving Jesus? When I encounter people in my life, do they walk away saying or thinking, she's got Jesus in her heart? Would I be found guilty of loving Jesus? Is my life reflecting the light of Christ? And then the final question I had was, how am I sharing the light of Christ with those around me? Again, that goes back to more than just collecting information, but doing something with it. And it is also it is the Great Commission to go and to make gospels and to share the good news and to spread it all across the earth. So that's how you do homiletics. I really hope you'll give it a try. You know, I'm here to help you. If you have questions, I would love to walk alongside of you. Maybe we could sit down and work through a passage together sometime. I would enjoy doing that. If you have any questions about homiletics, put them in the description or comments box below. If you have any prayer requests, feel free to do that there as well. I've enjoyed this Open Your Bible series with you. Have a little something different the next 2 weeks, and then I think I'm going to go back to doing some topical conversations with you for our Truthful Tuesdays. So as always, friends, thank you so much for being here with me. And remember, do not ever forget, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, mountains can be moved. God bless you.